last year when you sort of came in, you didn't hesitate to shuffle the lines a little bit and see how different guys looked with you know, different line mates. Is that something you anticipate? Because, you know, obviously a lot of us are trying to get an idea of what the roster is going to look like. So just curious, I mean, do you anticipate it, you know, moving guys around a little bit?
Absolutely. We know what our, you know, we know what our lineup looks like and how it works with how we ended up last year, but we've got some good new players that have come into our team, and we've got to now take a look at where they may fit best within the team now. So for us, we could be juggling people on a daily basis just to get a feel for that, because our, you know, our job at the end of the training camp is to understand and be comfortable with what our best lineup is going to look like going into Winnipeg. So any juggling that we do in the days leading up to that is going to be beneficial for us. So there's nothing that is written in stone right now. We've got a lot of guys that can play center ice. We've got a lot of guys that can play on the walls. We got some guys that can play on the off wing. So right now for us, it's about chemistry and what's going to give us the best four lines in order to put our best lineup forward on the first night. And that's our goal coming out of training camp.
Does that include those first two lines? Because there are some pretty established high-level players on those two lines that we've seen play together for a long time. So I'm just curious.
There's nothing in stone. I think we do ourselves a disservice if we don't take a look potentially at, what some new people may inject with some of the people that we have. So, like I said, we know what the lineup was like that we ended the year with, and we're comfortable with that lineup, but I think we're doing ourselves a disservice if we don't take the opportunity to try to see if we have a better potential lineup than the one we ended with.
I guess a lot has been talked about when it comes to rivalries, the North Division. We've all been talking about it. We've also all been talking about how many former Canucks are now on your roster, and now we see Travis Hammond go the other way. Can we just get a coach's perspective about how much fun these rivalries will be for you guys and how that will take on a life of its own? We don't want to make too much of it, but it is going to happen that we could see some nastiness with so much face to face.
Well, I think there's a lot of rivalry. I think that we're going to see it really quickly. Obviously the Calgary Edmonton rivalry, the Battle of Alberta, nobody has to say anything about. I think that'll get ramped up just with the amount of times that we're going to play each other. The Vancouver rivalry has been a good rivalry with the Flames already. I think, but again, exactly what you alluded to, the fact that we've got, you know, a lot of their players over on our side now, and, you know, they've signed Hammer over there to Vancouver. I think that's going to ramp that rivalry up pretty quickly. The fallout of the Winnipeg series last year, I think we'll get that those games going fairly quickly, and we're going to see them fairly soon a lot of times in the schedule. And then it doesn't take long in the East. I mean, you look at Ottawa, Kachuk versus Kachuk storyline, and they're going to be a much improved hockey team. So that's going to that'll ramp itself up naturally, and then of course you've got Montreal and Toronto, two of the original six teams, and I'm sure as we see each other a lot, we'll find ways to sort of build the dislike in, or however you want to call it, in terms of what goes into a rivalry game, or maybe the emotion is a better word for it. But I'm sure with the amount of times that everybody's going to play, the emotions will get ramped up, and the games will take on a special sort of appeal to everybody. From a fan standpoint, I think it's going to be fantastic. I mean, it's going to be must-watch TV, I think, every night. And being involved in some awful big rivalries over the years myself, what they do with a team emotionally, and it doesn't matter where teams are in the schedule. When you've got a rivalry game coming up, the standings don't matter. Both teams get up for that game. And so I think what we're going to see is a real elevated intensity level for most of the games in the regular season. So from a fan standpoint, it should be awesome. I'm looking forward to watching games myself when we're not playing. It's going to be something I've got on the TV, because I'm a fan as well. And as I said, it's going to be great.
So last year, you guys, players and staff all talked about how close this team was as a really positive thing. At the start of last regular season, you had that big team building getaway, and from then on it kind of dominated the conversation. So how do you try to create that closeness with the new faces when, you know, like a Banff getaway just isn't as likely, or do you have some team bonding stuff in the works for this camp?
Yeah, well, you know, we'll make sure that that sort of stuff gets in. I think it's important. I mean, all your team building experiences don't have to be formal ones. There's an awful lot of team building that can go on in an informal way. And we're certainly going to build those opportunities in. We've already done some things in terms of planning for more formal opportunities to team build. So it's going to continue for us. But it was a really big step for us as a team going through what we went through last year in the team building experience. And I think now we just have to continue to build on it. And that's going to be a fine sort of thing for us. We understand how good our chemistry was last year. And now we're going to ask, you know, our team to assimilate some new people in. So our dressing room is going to have to settle out over a little bit as people understand where they fit in, what the roles are going to be, how that's going to, you know, maybe impact some things in their personal space. We've got to make sure that we use the closeness and cohesion of our team to make sure those happen in a positive way so that, you know, we can assimilate some awful good, like a lot, all the guys that we brought in, we feel are really good culture players. They're really good professionals. I think they're going to fit well into our room, but we need to make them feel welcome, and they need to get to the point where they feel like they can contribute to what's going on here on a daily basis, not just in how they play, but also the impact that they can have in our room. So it's a big undertaking by us, but it certainly is one of the key things we're looking for coming out of camp.
Derek Wills.
Hey, Wardo, happy new year.
Yeah, same to you, Derek. How are you?
Doing well. A couple for you. With such a condensed training camp and no preseason games, is it going to be more of a challenge than it normally would be to balance evaluating players and giving guys an opportunity to earn or steal a job, and also, you know, getting your guys you've got penciled in ready for the regular season in about a week and a half?
No, because our outlook is not going to change in terms of what we ask the players to do coming into camp. We just want them to come in and show us what they can do. So there's no added pressure in terms of what the shorter time frame is gonna throw at us. What we're looking for is a staff doesn't change, whether it's over 1 month, whether it's over, you know, the shortened period that we have here. So, you know, the players can feel comfortable that, you know, they just have to come in and bring to the table what they bring to the table. Obviously, a lot of the decisions we're going to make are going to happen a lot quicker based on the time frame. But, you know, what we're worried about from a player standpoint is that they feel comfortable. They understand exactly what the landscape is going to look like, and they feel like they do get an opportunity to show us what they can do. So, you know, as we said in the last pause in the bubble before we went to Edmonton, you know, we had an awful lot of good showings from an awful lot of young guys. And for us, that's a positive thing. And that's the message that we wanted them to have leaving here, was that we have seen great improvement in your game. You've taken a big step forward. You need to feel good about your camp, even though you're not going to be on our team going to Edmonton. And so, you know, this whole thing is a process for our young players in terms of becoming a National Hockey League player. And as long as we give them good information about what they do when they perform here, it's going to be a positive step for everybody. And it's a step that we need to take in order for them to continue to develop. So for us and for those guys who don't make our team, they'll get right into the development process based on what they've shown here. And they will become active participants in those things with the coaches. And we will just get on, you know, we will get on track with them, making sure that they continue to push forward in a positive way. So the time frame for us isn't going to be something that's going to be detrimental for them in terms of having to add pressure on what they do. The guys have looked good coming in terms of their testing, in terms of their measurement and all that kind of stuff, their health. So, you know, we feel like they're in a good position in terms of what they've had to do to get themselves ready. And now it's just a matter of having to get out and show us what they can do on the ice over the next couple of weeks here.
Last one for you. Obviously, things happened pretty quickly when you took over as head coach last November, but wondering how much having a full offseason means to you. And I know it's sometimes difficult to make changes in the middle of the regular season, but should we maybe look for some changes now that you've had some time to make some?
Well, we didn't make all the changes that we wanted to make. Obviously, when the coaching change happened, just because we were right in the middle of the schedule. So one of the big balancing acts for us as a staff was to sort of determine how much we wanted to introduce that was new and when we wanted to do that. The bubble and the time leading up to the playoff situation in Edmonton gave us some opportunity to do a lot of new teaching. We put a lot of new structure into our play. I thought the guys did a good job with it through the course of the playoffs. That's going to benefit us now in terms of they understand and are comfortable with what some of those new expectations were and are. So for us now, it's going to be a lot of review. There's a few things that we still want to tinker with, but I'd say that we're probably 90% to the end in terms of really establishing everything that we want to put into our game. And those will be things that we work on moving forward here. I mean, we've got the opportunity through training camp to work on some of that, but we also have a week off relatively early in the schedule. And we've got 5 or 6 days there that we're going to be able to practice and really make sure that we're comfortable with what some of those new things are. There's going to be some new teaching there and that stretch of practices. And we're hopeful that by the end of that, the guys are going to be fairly comfortable with those final few things that we want to tinker with. And so we should be off and running then fully after that time.
Wes Gilbertson.
Hey, Geoff. Happy New Year.
Hey, Wes. Same to you. Happy New Year, man.
Thank you. I'm just kind of curious. You know, we always throw around the term training camp surprises, like, you know, that's some sort of great thing. And it strikes me that this year, the last thing we probably want to see at training camp is any sort of surprises. I'm curious, when you hop on that plane to Winnipeg on the 13th, what will have had to happen for you to say, yeah, camp went really well. We're ready for this.
Well, I think our goals coming out of training camp are to be rested as opposed to tired. I mean, I think sometimes, you know, you might set yourself up for a little bit of early failure if you do too much in training camp, if you drive them too hard. So we're going to make sure that we're rested and feeling good about going into that first game physically, mentally. That's going to be big for us. So rested is going to be there. Ready in terms of making sure and understanding that our guys are comfortable with our structure, whether that is through review, just really emphasizing some of the key points that we feel need to be in place in terms of how we play. And then anything new that we introduce, that there's a comfort level that the guys, you know, aren't going to be thinking too much about what that is. So really, that's what we're looking at coming out of training camp. And if we can get that and feel like that as a staff getting off the plane in Winnipeg, then I feel like we've had a good camp and we'll be ready to start. I mean, this is going to be a work in progress for all the teams, you know, with all the things that may come up. There's going to be challenges in schedule with respect to practice time. There's going to be challenges in the health potentially. There's going to be a lot of things that the teams are going to have to deal with. So, you know, I think you want to deal with things in this schedule in small periods of time. I think it's easier to focus players and focus staff in on that. And like I said, right now we're just looking ahead at our training camp and then we'll take the rest from there. But, in no way or stretch of the imagination do we feel like we need to be complete, by the 14th. We're not going to be complete. There's some things that we feel take precedence over some other things. If we can have those things in place and, you know, the guys are comfortable with those things and we're rested and we feel good about going into that first game, then we've had a successful camp.
Peter Labardius.
Hi, Geoff. Happy New Year.
Hey, Peter. How are you? Happy New Year.
I'm outstanding. Geoff, coaches love options and love internal competition. And with all the new additions since the summer, and even maybe with what you've observed in the last week or so, do you get a pretty strong sense already that everybody's well aware that it's different this time?
Yeah. I mean, we talked about it before, going into the bubble, there was just a feeling, you could feel it being around the guys that, there was a little bit of a more business-like approach and, just seeing the guys, since I've been here over the last few days is that, there's a business-like aspect about our group that's still there. You know, and they know, and they know that, that we have to take another step this year. And you can see that it's in the way that they've, you know, that they're carrying themselves, how they're doing things. You know, getting some feedback from Kent and the doctors, just how they've come in. You know, I think it's a real good step in order to start. But our, you know, we've got a really good chemistry about our team. We're excited about the new players that, you know, we've been able to bring in the off season. We feel like they're all culture guys. They all play the game the right way. They're going to add to our dressing room. They're going to add to what the product is on the ice, obviously. And, you know, we feel like we have a lot of options based on the talent level that's there, based on the, you know, some of the things I think where we can make advances in our culture and how that can be reinforced. So, you know, we got a lot of things that we feel real good about right now, but it's obviously it's all potential. And now we have to make sure that we get all the information that we need to gather over the next couple of weeks in order to make this all work, you know, to the best possible way that it can. And that's going to be a fun challenge for us. We're looking forward to it. And obviously it's not going to be just the coaching staff. The players have an ownership of our program. They're active participants in it. And so getting down and talking to the players and spending some time with them and really, you know, understanding what's on their mind and how we're going to be able to fit their ideas into where we need to go. It's going to be a great, it's going to be a great process for us. And we're excited about making that happen and starting it all. And so we're really looking forward to the next couple of weeks with our guys.
Haley Selvian.
Hi, Geoff.
Hey, Haley, how are you?
Good, how are you?
I'm good, thanks.
You know, I think a lot's been said, at least externally and within the media, about Johnny Gaudreau having, you know, maybe a down season, at least in terms of his offensive stats. I'm just curious if there's been anything that you've seen from Johnny that doesn't show up on the stat sheet or just things that you've seen from him in your time knowing him that could indicate a bounce back year is coming.
Well, he's come in with a big smile on his face. That's for sure. You know, there seems to be a weight lifted off his shoulders. And I think that naturally happens with a new season. We're not really concerned about what happened last year or what those thoughts are. We, you know, we left those things last year. You know, after we had our final calls, and we had our exit meeting. So that's all forgotten. We talked about the importance of moving forward. I know he's put an awful lot of time into preparing himself for this year. We put an awful lot of time in just to making sure that, you know, we're not talking about the past. We're talking about the future and we're looking forward to that. And I think for him, you know, he understands that he's just one guy on a hockey team that really cares about each other. So I think there's some strength that he can take from giving himself to the team. You know, we stress that an awful lot with our players. Like there's an energy that the team can give you as long as you give yourself to the group. And he certainly has always done that with our guys. So it's a new situation. It's a new year. And with that comes a new optimism, a new energy. And he's certainly, right in line with everybody else. He's excited about the season. And when you've got a player that's excited, now it's just a matter of going out and playing the game. So we're looking forward to the training camp. We're looking forward to the first couple of games and we'll take it from there. But he's come in, he looks like he's ready to go. He's all signs point that, his mind is on the present and looking forward to this season. And that's where it should be. And so for us, we're confident that that he's going to start off real well for us.
Donna Spencer.
Hi, Geoff. Happy New Year.
Hey, Donna. Happy New Year to you.
Geoff, can you explain the rationale or the goal behind the restructuring of the goaltending department? And also, what is the connection between that change and signing an expensive goaltender?
Well, I'm not sure if they're necessarily related events. As far as the restructuring of the goaltending department, If you look at every team now in the league, everybody's got people that go out and try to find goaltending talent. Everybody's got a guy that sort of oversees it. I mean, we talk about goaltending being the most important position, but we need to do the diligence with that position that we do with other positions. You know, you take a look at what our development sort of model looks like. We've got skills coaches for defensemen. We've got skills coaches for forwards. We've got, you know, guys that travel around and spend an awful lot of time with our guys, but we didn't really have a guy that went around as a specific goaltending guy to talk to our goaltenders and work with them on an individual basis. And, you know, most teams in the league are doing that now. So we just felt like it made us a stronger, you know, stronger organization developmentally, mainly in order to make the shift. And so, you know, Jordan Sigalet he's got a good feel for the position, obviously. I think being a goaltending coach helps. So when he goes down, it's important for us as a coaching staff that, you know, when a guy goes down and works with our goaltenders, he has a strong sort of background in coaching so that he's sort of talking about the things and understands the things that we demand from our players in terms of structure and how we play, so that he can pass that along to our goalies. He can work on their technical skills. He oversees the people that are going to be in direct contact with our goaltenders, so there's a continuity throughout the organization of what that sort of looks like. So, you know, we really felt like that was a necessary sort of opportunity for us to put into the Flames organization. Jordan's going to do a great job with it. He's going to oversee what Jason does here with our goaltenders. He's going to oversee what Spearsy does with the guys in the American League. He will spend an awful lot of time, and he's got a really good eye finding talent in terms of the goaltending position. He's proven that over his time with us. And so we get to, you know, we sort of get to optimize his abilities to do that too. So the whole model in terms of strengthening our development, I think, is really going to have huge dividends because of the move. And so that's why it was done. You know, in terms of signing Jacob, you know, I think you look at a guy that's an established goaltender in the league. He's eaten an awful lot of minutes up. That's not to say we weren't happy with our goaltending situation, but when you have an opportunity to get a guy that's elite in the league at the position, I think you have to take an opportunity to, you know, to make it happen if there's interest in him, you know, sort of coming to your team. And he's got an awful lot of friends on our team. So Calgary was a destination that, you know, he would feel comfortable coming to. Obviously there was some comfort level in terms of what he would get when he got here. He likes the city. And that's not any knock against the goaltenders that we have in terms of them being elite or them being good goalies. We just feel like if you can strengthen your depth, if you can make your position a strength even stronger, then you have to do it. And so we feel like going into the season, you know, we've got two real solid goaltenders. And in the shortened schedule of the way things are and the travel and everything else involved, we're going to need both guys. And so we feel like we're, you know, it's a position of strength for us.
Thanks.
Darren Haynes.
Hey, Geoff, how are you?
Good, Darren. How are you doing?
Good. So you've spent months and months preparing, anticipating, but at the end of the day, there's still so much new, different, and unique about this season that's coming up. What fascinates you the most to kind of see it play out and see, you know, how it unshape? You know, like, is there any one element that kind of, that you're just kind of curious to see how it plays out in real life once we get going?
For me, I think the baseball oriented schedule is going to be something that's interesting. As far as the length and the stretch of games and how they're put together, I mean, it's similar to the lockout, you know, realistically, the 48 game lockout. I think we played our first game on the 22nd of January that year. So, you know, there is some experience in terms of dealing with the shortened schedule. And a lot of our guys have played through it. They remember it. So, you know, I don't think the shortened schedule is going to be something that's tremendously new. There is some experience with it. But I think the way that the schedule is set up in terms of going into a city and playing a team three times potentially, and I think that's going to be different. I think that's going to ramp games up. I think you're going to see the intensity in the second and third games potentially rise. And with that, obviously, are going to be the, you know, potential implications with health. Obviously, when you're going into a new city and you're going to be there for some period of time, you know, the NHL did a great job in the bubble. You know, we're confident that they've done a great job in terms of everything they've explored in order to keep the players healthy with, you know, before the vaccinations have all taken place. But there are going to be, you know, the exposure is going to happen, I think. You look at every other sport, it's happened, you know, whether it be college football, the NFL, the NBA, Major League Baseball. I mean, everybody that's kind of gone with this kind of a schedule, we've seen that the virus has been able to sort of get in there. So, you know, what is going to happen with your team health-wise is going to be something that we're going to have to deal with and get some quick experience with. So I think those two things for us are really the new things that we're going to have to deal with that we maybe not have seen in the past. And our, you know, our medical staff and our training staff has done a great job, you know, throughout all of this time. But they're going to get a, you know, they're going to get a stern test coming into something that's a little bit different now. And so for ourselves as, you know, as players and coaches and everything else, I think that health is, everybody's going to put a premium on it. You know, what are you doing away from the rink and really giving yourselves an opportunity to stay, strong in terms of your depth, in terms of what your team starts out being, because if you make, you know, if you make some bad choices, potentially it could impact your club. I mean, you could, you know, what could happen? I mean, you look at what happened with the, you know, the quarterbacks in Denver, you know, just all of a sudden you're down quarterbacks. I mean, is that the same situation with goaltenders? You know, what could happen to a power play unit? Like, it's, you know, there's all kinds of things that potentially could happen that would throw you a huge curveball. So for us, those are the two things that we're sort of, you know, trying to think outside the box on right now for when it comes up that we're, you know, we've got some sort of plan in terms of how to deal with it. But, you know, I think until it really happens, you know, we're not going to know whether or not the things we're talking about are 100% accurate.
Mark Steven?
Yes, good afternoon, Geoff.
Hey, Mark, how are you?
Good. I just wanted to bring this up. Is there going to be a particular point of emphasis, thing you wanted to see improve more than another? Because this team had a good season last year. A lot of teams are chasing you, but you're chasing a lot of teams too. Is there one area that really needs to make a move to move you up in the standings where you want to be?
I'll tell you, for me, I mean, when you look at everything, you can take all the statistics, but for me, the most telling statistic is the goal differential, you know, which says something about, you know, your defensive productivity, but it also says something about your offensive productivity. And when you take a look at points, you can go through any, you know, schedule you want, but when you line up the teams by points and then you line the teams up by goal differential, it's almost identical, you know? So, you know, I think really what that says for us is that, you know, we understand that you give yourself a chance by being good away from the puck in this league, but you've got to be opportunistic when you get your chances offensively, when you get it back. So, you know, those are the things that we're going to be kind of focusing on an awful lot. Like, you know, do we have a good goal differential? And if we don't, why is that? Is it because we're not doing enough offensively, or, you know, we need to be better defensively? And that's really for us as a staff, that's going to be the main focus coming out of the gate right away.
Good. Thank you.
Salim.
Hey, Geoff. Hope you're doing well in the new year.
Hey, how are you?
Good. I'm wondering, Brad mentioned that morning skates could be making a comeback, and you might have touched on this, but just how are you planning to use those skates, and do you see them as having more value in a year like this than in previous years?
Well, they're going to have value for sure. You know, and the decision of whether to practice or whether not to practice, I think is going to potentially take on a little bit of a bigger impact than it would in a normal year. But for us, yeah, we have to use them as practices. It's going to be a situation where that happens. And so, you know, the usual float through in the morning is not going to happen. You may see that there's going to be some teaching and some structure, you know, put into those morning skates. I don't anticipate it being a lot, but you could see it, you know, in terms of reviewing one or two things on top of, you know, what you normally want to accomplish in a morning skate, just to prepare yourselves, because practice time is going to be at such a premium.
Danny Austin.
Hey, Geoff, I'm going to acknowledge this might be a little bit of a reach, but Brad mentioned that you're kind of breaking the guys into Team Iginla and Team McDonald, and obviously two towering figures in this organization's history. I mean, is that just honoring two guys who've made a big impact, or are you at all trying to sort of make sure this guy, this group understands where they fit into, you know, the club's history?
No, I think it's important to, you know, to have tradition involved in, you know, what you're doing now. I mean, I think tradition brings prestige to your club. I think it brings an awareness from young players for maybe what they want to aspire to. You know, like when you're talking about these two players, they're franchise players. We want our players to aspire to be franchise players. So I think the tie-in for us is important. I think it's a natural place to start. You know, I think it brings a little bit of a lift to the camp. I know, you know, in texting with Lanny and Jerome the other day, you know, they've got money on the inter squad games based on the names of their teams and everything else. So, you know, there's just a lot of fun that's built into it that'll carry over to our players. I think it'll bring attention to the history of the Flames that maybe some of our young guys haven't really researched yet. You know, Milan Lucic had the opportunity to play with Iggy on a line. I mean, he's a hockey historian. He really appreciates the game. He knows everything about it. You know, if you ask him questions about the past, the history of the NHL and everything, he's right on point with it. And we're hopeful that, you know, that might make some of our younger players just sort of go back and take a look at the organization that they're a part of now and what it means to be a Flame and what these players that won a Stanley Cup here sort of did for the city and have done for our team. And, you know, they're around. So when they're around, you know, it breaks down barriers so that players may be comfortable going up and talking to these people just because they've got so much to pass on. We want them to feel like they are. You know, I know on teams that have success, I mean, those players that hang around when they come into the locker room, it's special. And we want to make sure that our young players here have the opportunity to experience the same kind of thing. So we're going to have some fun with this. You know, we feel that it's a good way to get training camp kicked off. And you know, hopefully, as I said, it'll give a little bit of energy to our group, especially around the games, because we're trying to make it as game-like as possible for our players so that they get their timing in, they get their reps in, they're operating at a, you know, what they're going to see in terms of pace early. And we just think that all these things are helpful in attaining that.
Ryan Pike.
Hey, Geoff, how you doing?
Hey, Ryan, how are you?
I'm good. I'm curious. I mean, for the younger players in the organization, guys in their first or second or third camps, obviously it's a smaller camp group than usual, and you know, it's a much shorter camp than usual, so it's more of a sprint than you're used to. What are you hoping that the young guys take away from this experience that'll help them build their games in the future?
Well, I'm hoping they take away that they feel like, you know, they've got a chance, obviously. You know, I think a young player, when they come in, everybody, you know, as we say to them, just show us what you have. But I think it's important that a young player sort of understands where he wants to be. You know, I always feel like, and I tell players when they're going into new situations, decide really what team you want to be at. Like if you want to be an NHL player, then go in with the mindset that you're going to make the NHL team. And, you know, how do you do that? You go in and you play your game to the best of your ability. You play it competitively. You know, you really show the coaches exactly what you bring to the table. And so for us, we want the guys to feel like leaving camp that, you know what, maybe they're not that far away. That's one thing. We want them to also feel like, especially the guys that have been here for a couple of camps, we want them to feel like they know exactly where they improve so that they feel like they're, you know, they're progressing along their developmental path in order to becoming a Flame. And we want them to understand fully what it means to be a Flame. Like, we want them looking at some of those NHL players that are here already and understanding, you know, steps that they need to take in order to make the step to become a regular in our lineup. So those guys will be spending some time with our players. Right now, I think it's important that they ask questions. I think it's important that they watch how our players conduct themselves. I think all those things go into making a young player a better player. We want them to take all those opportunities. And then for us, obviously, at the end of the day, for the guys who aren't successful in making our team, we want them to know exactly what their sort of path looks like. We want to let them know realistically where they are along that path as they leave here. and what the next steps are in order to continue along that path with their development. So just understanding that they need to own the path, that they need to take responsibility in the path in terms of the coaches that they're going to be around. All those things are part and parcel of us having those guys have a good camp experience and leaving here, you know, with a good feeling that they're not that far away of being an NHL player, that they're confident that they can be an NHL player, and that they just really go away from the camp with a good feeling that they've had a good showing. So, you know, we're all in this together. We know that our development system is so critical, especially with the way that the game looks these days with free agency and that. And we want them to feel good about being Flames and exactly where they're at in terms of the Flame family. So all those things for us are critical. We think that we're going to be able to offer that to all of our players through the course of the training camp. And we're looking forward to, you know, getting to know those guys and getting the opportunity to work with them over the next little bit and seeing where it all and, you know, where it all goes to at the end of training camp. I mean, we do have questions. The American League, you know, obviously is still, I think, a work in progress in terms of what that may look like. But we do have it, you know, there is the question of the taxi squad and what that's going to look like too. So when you really look at it, I think there's, you know, there's some more opportunity for some guys to stick around than normal that we, you know, we'd be shipping out. I mean, we're going to be keeping six players like real close to our team in the same building with our team, working with our team. So, you know, that's six more places than maybe normally you would have coming out of a normal training camp.
Pat Steinberg.
Hey, Geoff.
Hey, Pat.
You talked, I think it was last week, you kind of talked about the idea of putting players at different positions and trying them at different spots and how you'd kind of be doing a disservice to yourself and the team if you didn't at the very least look at that. Can you expand on that and why looking at different options and different combinations is so important?
Well, I think the biggest thing, Pat, is that, you know, with the demands on the schedule and believe me, based on, you know, what I've sort of gone through before you know, the lockout shortened schedules, the games are going to come fast and furious. And rest is going to be so critical. So, you know, we feel like the depth is really, really necessary. So right away, you know, we need to understand what four groups of players are going to give us our best lineup in order to go out and not only deal with schedule, but to be the best team that we can be. So we want to see what those potential combinations could be, you know. Will it impact matchups? For sure it'll impact matchups. You know, can we play guys on wings that maybe normally aren't wingers so that we can get a matchup we want going into a road situation where we're going to be for three games? You know, so we want to know if guys can make that switch. We feel like we're really strong at center ice. And so when you're going to build championships teams, you want to build up the middle. We feel like we've really, you know, done some things in terms of being able to strengthen our middle. So, you know, what are those, you know, who are going to be the four guys that are there? Because we got a lot of candidates for that. So, you know, I think we're going to play around with that. We want to see where the new guys are going to fit in. So I think it's if we just slot them in with, you know, one or two guys from the beginning of camp, we may not necessarily see the best possible fit where they could fit in. So I think all these things are really important for us to understand and know as a staff, when we get down to, you know, to the puck dropping in Winnipeg for game one, because once that happens, you know, you're going to snap your fingers and you're going to be sitting there with, you know, 15 games left and you're going, oh, wow, where did this season go? So, you know, how you're going to come out of the gate is going to be so critical. We talk about it being important every year, but, you know, in this shortened schedule, you know, the start, you really want to have a good one, because if you come out with a bad one or you come out not really understanding what your best potential fits are going to be, I think it's going to be hard for teams to, you know, to come back from an extended losing streak, especially early in the schedule.
Okay, it looks like our last question here is with Brendan Parker.
Hey, Geoff, happy new year.
Yeah, same to you, Brendan. How are you?
Good, doing well. Hope you're doing well as well. I just wanted to ask you a little bit, two-part kind of on the follow-up to what you were explaining about assimilating some of those new guys in and that process. You know, Brad actually mentioned just that there's been a good core group here really since October, training and skating at the rink, and then the majority of the roster has been here for about a month. How beneficial is that, knowing just how short this training camp is, how limited time you have on the ice, but just the fact that a lot of that work has maybe been put in place already here over the last month? Well, and then
Yeah, I think it's awesome. I think it says something about the maturity of our team, and I think it says something about where the focus of our team is in terms of getting themselves ready for the season. So, you know, that's been a real positive for us, obviously. I know it hasn't been that way in some other cities, but I think it says something about the maturity of our group. And I think it says something about how much our team likes being around each other. I mean, when you're, you know, when you've been grinding away with guys for that long, you know, you really gotta like them. You know, there's no question. They've, you know, from all reports I've gotten, they've, you know, they've been coming to the rink. They're doing their work, but they're having fun together too. And I think that's a big thing. So I think it says something to those two things. And now, you know, really the challenge for us as a team is to make good on all of the preparation that our team members have put in, and you know, really take on the challenge as a group to take that next step.
All right, Kelly Rudy.
Hey, Geoff, how are you?
Kelly, how are you?
Fantastic, thanks. Looking forward to a strange year. I don't have a question for you, but I just want to say look forward to the season. Good luck, and hopefully we bump into each other. I don't know how it's going to work with any of us broadcasters, but anyways, I'm looking forward to it, and nice chatting with you, bud.
Yeah, good seeing you. Happy New Year. And
you too.
I get to see Big Lou hunting every once in a while when I flip the TV.
I know, right? And the other Lou, I don't know if you've had a chance, but on Instagram, Peter Lubardius with his son after the Canadian games. That's just great stuff. It's awesome. So looking forward to hockey again.
Yeah, good. Yeah, us as well. It's good seeing you.
Yes.